As pitchers and catchers dusted the grime of the previous season off their gear and the snow from their driveway to make their way south for spring training in 1983, Americans of all ilk labored under the increasing infatuation with Star Wars of various types. Fans of George Lucas' franchise were anxious for summer to arrive, bringing with it the last installment of the good versus evil blockbuster series that had been absent from theaters for 3 years. In Washington, President Ronald Reagan unleashed his plans for the Strategic Defense Initiative, or the SDI, including the proposed construction of a web of lasers that would shoot down any missile hurled our way from, say, the Soviet Union. The high-tech nature of that idea caused politicians on the other side of the aisle to scoff and prompted Ted Kennedy to dub the scheme, yes, Star Wars. Against his background of Cold War posturing and box office anticipation, baseball fans were happy to dig out of another cold winter to find their game on the brink of another round of its own brand of Star Wars. Stars are born. The 1982 season had seen the emergence of a few players, not merely to star status, but into the stratosphere superstars. As Dale Murphy of the Atlanta Braves and Robin Yount of the Milwaukee Brewers hammered the competition en route to taking the National League and American League MVP awards, respectively, they also lifted their teams to division championships. Joining those teams in the playoffs were the aging but powerful California Angels and the perennial contending St. Louis Cardinals, led by flashy shortstop Ozzie Smith. While the Cards swept Atlanta in the NLCS, it took the Brewers 5 full games to dispatch California in the ALCS. A thrilling 7-game World Series followed, leaving the Cardinals as world champions and the Brewers as favorites of the working men everywhere. And fans greeted the new season with a gripping question: would the Brewers or some startup shatter baseball's traditional power structure, or would the franchises of the past regain their pedestals from which they had fallen during that gritty season in 1982? Though it would take most of the summer of 1983 to answer that question, baseball card collectors found out early that spring that their world was changing for the better. Because after 2 years of increased competition following Fleer's landmark court victory in 1980 led to a string of dismal cardboard issues, the first ripped wax wrappers in the new year revealed a ray of light. No matter what the upcoming season had in store, 1983 Topps baseball cards were a bright beacon that would draw us back to our shoebox treasures all year long and for decades to come. Picture in picture. George Lucas and Ronald Reagan weren't the only technological inventors in 1983, as it turns out. As cable television subscription proliferated across America and viewers struggled to cope with the flood of new channels available to them, television manufacturer Philips decided to try something to help out the market, and of course, to capitalize on the market. In particular, Philips endowed its high-end sets that year with picture-in-picture, or PIP technology. First piloted in 1976 by Quintel in the 1976 Montreal Olympics. The idea was that you could watch one program on the large main screen of your TV and then load up another channel in a small box that lay over top a small portion of the full panel. Whether Topps confabbed with Philips on the idea of picture-in-picture is not clear from our vantage point all these years later, but what is certain is that the old gum company brought a pasteboard version of PIP to the baseball cards that year. First, the picture. Each card front of the 1983 Topps set is dominated by a large, full-color photo of the player in question, covering roughly the upper 80% of the available real estate. That image is surrounded by a tiny black border and then a thin line in one of the team colors, with the Topps logo in the upper right-hand corner. Under the main photo is a box bordered by another team-related color, with the team name embedded in a thick band towards the bottom of the card. In a white swath above the team's name, the player's name appears in the same color as the upper border, and his position is listed in black type. As was the norm in those days, the entire thing is set off by a fairly thick white border. Then the picture-in-picture. What wasn't typical at all, and what sets the 1983 Tops apart from the drab issues that came before it and opened up an array of artistic possibilities, was the round headshots of the players that juts out into the main photo, and it's positioned either in the lower left-hand or the lower right-hand corner. It's similar to the layout Tops used in 1963, but with a flip in the emphasis. Whereas the inset of the 1963 top set generally showed a player in the posed action shot, the 1983 cameo is all head and face. At the same time, Tops replaced the portraits used in their main panel for most of 1963 cards with some of the best action photography collectors had ever seen in regular base issues to that point. The result is an aesthetic winner that gives collectors a sense of both the player and the action on the field, and represented a marked improvement over just about every card issued in 1981 and 1982. Adding to that general impression of quality was the fact that most of the action photos in 1983 Tops were snapped on sunny days, flooding each card with bright, crisp imagery. The combination of these factors makes 1983 Tops sparkle in comparison to other issues of the era. Some things never change, but the back of 1983 cards is all Tops, from the gray-brown cardboard to the season highlights box. Each horizontally oriented card back starts with a card number in small black type against a gray background in the upper left-hand corner. The player's name appears in large black block letters across the top of the card. Nestled near the card number, an orange silhouette of a batter protrudes from a lighter orange box containing vital information. Beneath that is the usual complete statistical record that fans have come to love and depend upon in the days before baseballreference.com. Of course, even the masters crank out a clunker now and then. The observe of each card wraps up with the aforementioned 1982 season highlights block where space allows. Long in the tooth, fellows like Pete Rose number 100 weren't afforded such luxuries because their stats overflowed their bounds in typeface small enough for a pocket Bible. Even though the backs are fairly boring and very topsy-y, the contrast of heavy black ink against various shades of orange is a marked improvement in readability when compared to the blue-on-green scheme from the year before. From top to bottom and from front to back, the 1983 Tops is one of the more attractive sets of the 1980s, and for most collectors, a classic design that never gets old. Veterans? Super! Of course, a great design is not enough to make your baseball card set a hit. Otherwise, every graphic designer with a little leaguer at home would be churning out world-changing cards each spring. Indeed, if Tops learned anything about baseball cards during the first 33 years of business, it was that player selection can make or break a set. Their ability to ink players to exclusive contracts contributed greatly to the company's ability to strangle out Bowman in 1950s and keep other card manufacturers at bay for nearly three decades. Although Tops was no longer able to keep players off their competitors' cardboard by 1983, the old gum company nonetheless maintained a strong focus on star power. It was an easy task, really, because the early 1980s witnessed a gaggle of players winding down fine careers that would surely lead them to Cooperstown someday. Among those future Hall of Famers in their twilight years were Rolly Fingers, Johnny Bench, Steve Carlton, Pete Rose, Don Sutton, Bruce Sutter, Rod Carew, Fergie Jenkins, Rich Gossage, Jim Palmer, Reggie Jackson, Carl Yastrzemski, Tom Seaver, and Joe Morgan. There were also a few guys who had hung around forever and looked like they might have Hall of Fame potential, but who weren't quite locks in 1983. Phil Niekro, Gaylord Perry, Tony Pettis, Tommy John. All but John eventually got their plaques. It may seem blasphemous now, but none of us really knew what to do with Nolan Ryan in 1983. He was creeping towards his late 30s and was still mowing down batters better than anyone else. He had never progressed from thrower to pitcher in many minds. He couldn't continue to bring the heat forever, could he? Turns out, he very nearly did. Beyond the geezers, there were plenty of guys tearing it up on the field who were just getting started or who were in their prime years as the new season dawned. Some of the biggest names in the game included Jim Rice, Fernando Valenzuela, Alan Trammell, Ripken, Ricky Henderson, Dennis Eckersley, Burt Blyleven, Mike Schmidt, Yount, Gary Carter, Ron Guidry, Lou Whitaker, Eddie Murray, Tim Raines, George Brett, Paul Molitor, Andre Dawson, and Murphy. So Topps definitely had their bases covered when it came to star power in 1983, but they weren't content with offering just one card of each big name. Among the many special subsets included in the base issue were a series of 35 super veteran cards featuring select players who had logged 10 or more years in the majors. Each horizontal super veteran card represents a sepia-toned image of the player from his rookie season on the left-hand side and a more recent color image on the right-hand side. Card backs are oriented vertically and list career milestones and highlights for the players. Scattered throughout the set, each super veteran card appears one number higher than the player's base card. Schmidt's super veteran is number 301, for example. John Wathen, baseball icon. As great as those superstars and Hall of Famers were, though, the 1983 top set rolled out impeccable player selection from the very beginning, starting with card number 1, Tony Armas. Somehow, Ricky Henderson sneaked into the mix at number 2, but then a run of awesomeness at the front of the set continued with Greg Minton, Lance Parrish, Manny Trejo, and John Wathen. These are the famous record-breaker cards that Topps loved to inject in the mix back in the 70s and 80s, and some of the choices are suspicious at best. I mean, sure, Henderson stole 130 bases in 1982, but did you know he only played in 149 games that season? If only Ricky could have stayed on the field, he might have really been something. No, in the spring of 1983, it was that Wathen card that had boys on the playground, or at least one boy on the playground, riled up. That a catcher had somehow managed to steal 36 bases in a season instantly elevated him to God status for young collectors, fully immersing themselves in the game for the first time. If Wathen could do it, maybe we could too, right? Certainly, he was more realistic a role model than Topps provided on cards number 386 to 407, where the 1982 All-Stars lived. Running the gamut from Rod Carew to Pete Vukovich to Tim Raines, this 22-card subset hit many of the big names from the previous year's Summer Classic. The cards were inspiring in the talent they showcased, but the big blue stars in the lower left-hand corner of the cards were intimidating and begged a couple of questions. Who among us might someday be worthy of our own five-pointed accolades, and how in the world did John Wathen not end up so honored? The mind boggles. Another of Topps' yearly subsets, the League Leader cards, 701 to 708, also presented plenty of conundrums when you look back on them decades later. How come Floyd Bannister didn't become Nolan Ryan? Al Oliver really won a double crown at age 71? Is that thing on Gorman Thomas's lip extinct? What is a Quisenberry? Topps didn't give us answers to those questions, but they did give us even more subsets. In particular, we got 26 team leader cards, one per team, showing each club's leaders in batting average and earned run average. 26 manager cards depicting each club skipper. 6 checklist cards that list out every card in the set. And while those were the extent of the designated special subsets in 1983 Topps, it turns out that the issue held a group of cards that would become more monumental as the months and years wore on. It's just that hardly anyone realized it at the time. Rookies before rookies were cool. As the 1983 season loomed, collectors were just starting to warm to the idea that we should prefer a player's rookie card over any other card in which they appeared. If we had doubts, there were frequent articles in our favorite hobby publications and ready advice from our local card dealers to drive home the point. And that point was that there were fewer cards in existence from the early years of a superstar's career than from the twilight. It made sense. Nobody cared much about baseball cards when Pete Rose debuted in 1963, for example, but the little swatches of cardboard were getting pretty popular by 1983. Chances are the card companies had amped up their production iron over the years, and it was almost a certainty that tons of those 1963 Charlie Hustle floating head cards had bit the dust long ago, courtesy of careless young hands and uncaring mothers and life in general. For collectors eager to jump on the rookie boat, the 1983 top set proved to be a revelation, eventually. There is no denying that the issue is loaded like few others when it comes to rookie Hall of Famers, because Wade Boggs, Tony Gwynn, and Ryan Sandberg all made their cardboard debuts in the 1983 tops. The thing is, though, nobody cared about those guys at all when their cards first hit the store shelves. Though Boggs had hit 349 in 100-plus games for the Boston Red Sox in 1982, nobody outside of New England knew about it. He was also 24 years old and had a flash-in-the-pan feel. Sandberg had finally landed a steady gig with the Chicago Cubs after struggling to reach the majors with the Philadelphia Phillies, but he was shaping up to be a good third baseman with limited power. Nothing too exciting, in other words. And who was Tony Gwynn? Just a light-hitting outfielder for the woeful San Diego Padres, as far as anyone could tell, if anyone even bothered to look at all. So the trio of rookie cards that would eventually define the set and help give legs to the rookie card phenomenon itself slid to the bottom of our shoeboxes and angled towards the common bins. No, when it came to rookie cards in 1983, there were a scant few that really mattered. Everyone loved the 1952 Topps Mickey Mantle card, even though we were later forced to admit that it really wasn't a rookie card. Rose's rookie was starting to get some play as he moved closer to Ty Cobb's all-time record for base knocks. And Cal Ripken Jr., the monstrous wunderkid shortstop from the Baltimore Orioles who won the Rookie of the Year award in 1982, was tops among young players of the day when it came to rookie card buzz. But once the season started, all of our rookie card gazes turned towards the horizon of autumn and the Topps traded set we knew would be released in November. We just couldn't wait to get our hands on the first cards of the superstar rookie bashers who emerged during that summer of 1983, Dale Strawberry and Ron Kittle. Younger collectors today might be forgiven if they draw a blank on Kittle, and even Strawberry may invoke a large, vague notion of potential unfulfilled. Trust me, though, these guys were the bomb during the heat of 1983, largely because they smashed bombs. As expected, their Topps traded cards sold like earplugs at a Marge Shot concert, but the euphoria was short-lived. Kittle never again approached the heights of his rookie season, and while Strawberry performed at otherworldly levels for a few years, life got the better of him and his career, just like those creased and dog-eared Rose rookie cards. Even though Kittle and Strawberry left fans and collectors feeling cheated, their mediocre rise at the moment in collecting history helped fuel the rookie card hype that would lift up every rookie card produced for the next 10 years or more. That included, of course, the pasteboards of Boggs, Gwynn, and Sandberg as their own stars began to shine in subsequent seasons. As we look back on the set now, we can see that the terrific trio aren't the only rookies of note in 1983 Topps. Among the others are Willie McGee, Bud Black, Dave Dravecki, Gary Gaetti, Frank Viola. Besides all that, 1983 Topps even gave us a bonus rookie card. That youngster trying to scurry back to first base while Reggie Smith waits for the ball on card number 282? Well, that's none other than Rhino himself, yet again. It's no wonder rookie fever got us all eventually. And it's no wonder that Topps was able to fit in all those rookies either. For the second year in a row, the Topps base issue weighed in at a massive 792 cards, which would hold as its standard through 1994. Collectors had plenty of ways to get their Topps fixed, too, starting with the standard wax pack. These hobby staples came 36 to a box, with each pack containing 15 cards, a stick of gum, and a game card that let you vie for the World Series trip, all for 30 cents. If you wanted more cards per setting, you could opt for a cello pack, which offered 28 cards, a stick of gum, and a game piece for 49 cents. Each cello box held 24 packs. For those who wanted even bigger slab of cards, or more accurately, multiple slabs of cards, Topps offered a rack pack option. Rack packs came 24 to a box. Each pack delivered a whopping 51 cards with no on-package prices. Stores could set their own price, evidently. Topps also produced the meatiest of all options, 500-card vending boxes, which featured nothing but the box and cards. They were pure collector's or investor's delight, especially when encountered in their native habitat of the vending case. 24 vending boxes packed neatly together in a Topps labeled outer box. Oh, how many boyhood collector dreams were fueled by visions of wallowing in the fruits of such excess spilled across the bedroom carpet. When the holidays rolled around, Topps made one more grab for hobby dollars by offering a complete set of their base issue for $15.99 through the JCPenney catalog. Finally, even though Topps had the reputation as being the stodgy old man among card manufacturers, they were keen on experimentation. You can see this throughout their Monopoly era sets with such curiosities as 3D cards, miniature cards of their base set, deckle edges, supers, and on and on. In 1983, the adventurous spirit manifested itself in a test run of wax packs that were actually colored cellophane or other Marlar-like material featuring two crimped ends. The packs contained the standard 15 cards, a stick of gum, and a game card, but they eliminated the scorch of wax-stained cards. They also were effective in thwarting unscrupulous souls who liked to pop open the wax packs and slip out the best cards and reseal the packs. While these packs have been dubbed Michigan Wax, the test region expanded further than that, spreading into central Indiana and likely other areas as well. And although collectors at the time were lukewarm on the concept of ditching their beloved wax wrappers, it was an innovation copied by Sport Flicks and Score when they came on the hobby scene a few years later. By the early 1990s, anti-tampering packs were the hobby standard, and it was a grumpy old bear of a manufacturer that led the way. Is that a trapper keeper? All those wax, cello, and Michigan packs may have paled compared to their rack and vending counterparts when it came to sheer number of cards delivered under one wrapper. But those more diminutive choices didn't stop giving once all the Rufino Leonidas cards were shuttled to the common bins. Those game cards previously mentioned, seated one per pack, didn't just give collectors a chance to win a trip to the World Series or a ColecoVision system. For those of us losers, which was like everybody, each scratch-off card delivered between 1 and 5 bonus runs. When you collected 25 bonus runs, you can send in the game cards, along with 50 cents, to claim one of 8 5-card groups of super glossy cards that you couldn't get anywhere else. As you might expect, the 40 cards in the glossy send-in series showcased the brightest names in the game, Ripken, Rose, Schmidt, but the set also picked up some lesser highlights. Terry Kennedy, Rupert Jones, Toby Hera. Player selection was only part of the story with these beauties, though, because the design moved forward towards the type of aesthetic qualities that hardcore collectors had clamored for since the 1976 SSPC set. Near full bled photos, minimal design elements, thick white stock, and high gloss fronts. As much credit as the other companies, especially Upper Deck, gets for moving the quality of cards forward later in the decade and into the 1990s, it was Old Topps who was a good card generation ahead of its time with their first glossy send-ins. Topps didn't stop there with their extra 1983 issues either. If you were lucky enough to pull a winning lineup card from wax or cello packs, you won a 1982 league leader sheet, which featured, surprise, 9 league leaders in various statistical categories from 1982. The cards mimic the player's base 1983 set, with a box included on card fronts to denote their 1982 accomplishments. In a slightly more traditional vein, Topps produced a set of player stickers for the fourth year in a row. In 1983, the stickers were issued 6 per pouch, 100 pouches per box. Each pouch carried a suggested retail price of 25 cents, and collectors could purchase an album in which to affix their stickers for another quarter. Not traditional at all were the baseball foldouts that Topps issued for the first and last time. Each accordion foldout expanded to reveal 17 postcard-sized photos of active leaders in 1 in 5 statistical categories: batting average, home runs, stolen bases, wins, and saves. For a young kid trying to work his way through the confusion of following Major League Baseball seriously for the first time, each tiny trapper keeper stuffed with baseball goodness was a crash course on identifying the active legends of the game. And if you wanted to revel in cards of some all-time legends without mortgaging your Rambler to do so, Topps could accommodate you too. Recognizing that the hobby was heating up for real and wanting to capitalize, the Old Gum Company went into the well that only they could find. And they revisited over and over since, the Topps Archives. In particular, for the first time, Topps reprinted one of their classic sets, and it should surprise no one that they chose 1952 Topps for that honor. Although Topps was unable to secure player contracts for five of the original players, and although initial collector reaction to paying $35 for 402 reprints was tepid, the set has gained popularity over the years. Owing partly to the perceived small print run of the issue, believed to be about 10,000 sets, and largely because of the continued love affair with the real 1952s and the high prices, the 1952 Topps reprint set can bring close to $300 at auction today in its original sealed box. The straw that stirred the hobby. One extra 1983 Topps set that didn't need any time at all to capture the hearts of collectors was the last one of the year, the aforementioned 1983 Topps Traded Series. For the third year in a row, Topps issued their traded sets around Thanksgiving, just in time for the holidays and the Christmas buying season. By the time early copies hit the convention and card show floors, collectors were already frothing with anticipation, and the cards eclipsed all of the issues of the year in just a few days. The reason for all the excitement was, of course, the inclusion of the first ever card for baseball's new super-duper star, Darryl Strawberry. At just 21 years of age, and despite playing only 122 games that summer, Strawberry parlayed his long, lean frame into 26 home runs for the New York Mets. It was enough to ignite imaginations in the Big Apple and all across the game, and with the rookie card craze starting to burn, Strawberry was fuel for the fire. And he wasn't the only one, either. The upstart Chicago White Sox jumped from third to first in the old AL West thanks in no small part to their own mashing rookie, left fielder Ron Kittle. By season's end, Kittle had slammed 35 home runs and nestled right in behind Strawberry as the hottest commodity in the hobby. Unlike Strawberry, Kittle's first card came in the 1983 Flair set, so collectors had something to latch onto during the long season. We all wanted a piece of his first Topps card anyway, though. The traded set delivered both young sluggers and a lot more. As in the previous 2 years, the 1983 Topps traded set was issued in its own box and consisted of 131 players and managers who changed teams or debuted during the 1983 season, plus a checklist. Unlike mainstream Topps sets of the past, though, 1983 Topps Traded featured bright white cream cardstock that gave the already gorgeous cards an even more attractive appearance. Collectors loved the new look of the cards, but that also worked against Topps in subsequent years. If the old gum company could produce such beautiful cards in their season-ending sets, why did they revert to their standard soft brown cardstock for their base sets each spring? It was a question that we asked time and time again, and Topps' unwillingness to answer it opened the door for other companies to come in and steal our hearts and our dollars. We might not have realized it as 1983 faded into another bleak winter, but we had just witnessed the last best gasp of the king of cards until after the hobby boom was done. Last hurrah. As Topps was putting the finishing touches on the gleaming set that would make its subsequent issue seem lackluster by comparison, 1983 Topps traded. The ancient Philadelphia Phillies were making their last gasp push for the playoffs. Dubbed the Whiz Kids, in defiance to the team's Wunderkind-laden Whiz Kids version in 1950, the Phils won the old National League East thanks in parts to the efforts of Pete Rose, Joe Morgan, Tony Pettis, Bill Robinson, and Ron Reed, all of whom were over 40 and most of whom saw significant playing time for Philadelphia throughout the summer. Steve Carlton was 38, Tug McGraw was 39, and even Mike Schmidt was 34. The Phillies felt more like an old-timer squad than champions of anything. But they outdistanced the Pittsburgh Pirates by 6 games and then took the NLCS from the Los Angeles Dodgers 3-1. As the October nights grew longer and colder, the gray-bearded Phillies lined up against the mighty Baltimore Orioles, they who had their own way, and the hottest shortstop who was going to dominate the game for decades. For boys who worshipped the game and their own fathers, we had no choice but to root for the Phils because in many ways, they were our fathers, and the old men were reaching for one last cupful of glory. For baseball card collectors, the Phillies were Topps too, an iconic twist given that startup flair was based right there in Philadelphia. The Phils, dismissed by so many as too old or too stodgy to compete in a young man's game, had put it all together one last time and produced one of their greatest, most memorable seasons ever. But the writing was on the wall as the World Series got underway and the Orioles began to pull away, much like the Return of the Jedi had done all summer. The Phillies had proven to still be a blockbuster draw, but were not immune to the ravages of time. The Star Wars franchise and the Phillies franchise both were quickly aging, and neither were able to recapture its 1980s peak. Still, when Cal Ripken jammed his glove into the air to stab Gary Maddox's liner to end Game 5 and the series, it was a dagger to the Phillies and to the underdog rooters everywhere. The anointed golden boy had indeed ascended to the throne, and the old men who had dared challenge him slumped to the turf, suddenly mortal and faced with an unsure future. You have to wonder if Cy Berger's pulse ticked up a notch in that moment as the Orioles swarmed the field in celebration, whether he recognized tops in the dejected faces and thickening bodies of Rose, Pettis, and Morgan. The old gum company was headed into another winter with the Wolves pawing at their doors, yet Topps, too, had risen to grand heights in 1983. Would they fare better than the Phils? The following years would not be kind to either storied organization, and both exited the 1980s pocked by barbs of competition and struggling to find a glimmer of past glory. The pair of second-place finishes for the Phillies and a popular but common-as-dirt 1987 set were the best the duo could muster. No matter how dark the horizon looked, though, both Phils fans and baseball card collectors could always pull out our shoeboxes and return to the sun-soaked fields of our 1983 Topps cards. And the great thing is, we still can. Like our video? Then like our videos and subscribe to our channel. WaxpackGods.com